9 months. And finally, my mother summons the courage to let go of this child. I land with my physics instincts on, a cold wind perforating through my ears. Meanwhile, my mouth doing a sound test, much to the consternation of all the sundry. I was born in 1999, January, arguably one of the worst months in each and every household. Why say so? Because January comes just after the festivals, festivals of winter break, and just when the new year bills start reminding you to set better resolutions. Finally, I was here. 2 years from the day the goods landed, and I still can't walk. Talk of witchcraft. Talk of how bewitched I was for not only being born in January, but also at 5 a.m., her eyes in every corner of my village. My village of Sabaz. The situation is made worse by the fact that the nearest hospital was 200 kilometers away from where I was. So, if you're still wondering, I'm the fifth one. So the others before me who've undergone through the same, but almost similar situation. This made my parents reluctant. They don't get to notice my condition until I am 2 years. I'm 3 years. That's when they get to take me to a hospital. My mom, she hates the white beauty. While she has seen my limbs wither, feeding a family of six has not been easy for her. But in that white building, she's told that this is no witchcraft. It's not juju, it's not kamote, or whatever you call it in your language. I've just not been well fed. So from then on, she takes this to heart and tries to at least give me 3 meals a day for the next couple of years. At this particular point, my only hope is not to get well because it will make me feel better. No, it's to get well before another kid pops out because I knew this was too good to be true. I am but one story in a continent whose child mortality rate still remains alarming. According to UNICEF reports done in 2016, it showed that the number of deaths by every 1,000 kids had actually reduced. So is this something that we should be proud of as Africans? No, given the fact that we as Africans are still contributing to the largest amount of deaths by every 1,000 kids. Well, before somebody places a gun on my head because of saying that, let me clarify myself. I'm not saying that it's the same situation in each and every part of Africa. No. What I'm trying to say is that we as Africans need to come together and come up with solutions geared to solving this issue. What then is our way forward? You know, it's so sad I'm standing here and talking about Africa winning as one of the most malnutrited continents on earth, yet in the same vein, we win as the most arable place on earth. What a contrast. We need to do more. Otherwise, these numbers of child mortality, these numbers of hunger, these numbers of starvation will keep on rising if we as a continent do not take a pause and reevaluate how we approach our agriculture. With 1.16 billion people, 60% of it live in rural areas. So this to mean that Africa's economy is inherently dependent on agriculture. I'm not here to discuss about the effects of lack of food or anything like that, of that sort. I'm here to talk about solutions. One of the many solutions that I'm passionate about is automation. Yes, we need to embrace automation in our agriculture as Africans. Fewer people imagine themselves in this profession of farming. So imagine the situation whereby you have a billion mouths only being fed by a handful of people. Hindrances of the current methods of farming, such as costs, poor farming, or poor timing with regard to seed planting, harvesting, need to be overcome soonest. And one of the ways to do so is by use of robots, which range from simple appliances to heavy ones. And by robots, I mean this one. With a huge chunk of arable land not being cultivated, A good example is Sudan, whose current land that's being cultivated stands at 0.39 out of 1. It has dropped from 0.8 in the last 50 years. And an agriculture that entirely depends on weather. We, Africans, the future of Africa and that of the rest of the world hangs on a cliff unless something is done differently to leverage our produce. What then is the way forward? As I say, automation. We need to inculcate smarter machines in our farm activities. What then does this automation I'm talking about bring to us? First thing, precision farming. A concept simply put by Shimusawa in his article in 2014, it entails doing the right thing at the right time with the right resources to the right thing. Doing the right thing at the right time with the right resources to the right thing. Take an analogy of a teacher with his 30 students in class. The teacher cannot just stand in front of them and assume that they all have the same capability, they all have the same brain processing power, and expect the same results from each and every student. For the teacher to maximize or tap the potential of each and every student, he or she has to lower himself or herself to one-on-one basis, or one-on-one interaction with the student. The same thing we need to do in agricultural activities. So oftentimes we as farmers assume that just because maybe we're cultivating the same type of crop, just because we are cultivating in the same type of land, in the same field, that the plants require the same amount of inputs such as fertilizers, inputs such as herbicides and all that. But this is not the case. And this, in doing so, we do not get to leverage our produce. For the precision farming to be actualized, you need robots. Robots that are going to take data of each and every plant. The last point, energy input. The current energy input of agricultural activities stands at 55%. We're inputting so much and yet we're getting so little out of it. 45%, if that's the output. With the current methods of farming, we stand at a position to lose. As economists would say, investing so much in getting meat out of it does not make any sense. But we as Africans are still continuing to do that. It's the high time we eliminate some things. It's the high time we choose automation. Well, I know that there are other underlying factors that may be considered or that may arise in the process of robotizing our agriculture in Africa. But we as Africans need to see beyond this. Our potential as Africans, our potential in these lands is immense. From the banks of River Nile to the banks of River Niger and any other parts of Africa. But how we choose to channel it, how we choose to channel this potential that's lying on our lands is what will make or break us. Thank you.